On the show today, we meet veteran actor Soni Razdan and her beautiful, talented daughters, author Shaheen and superstar actor Alia Bhatt, who are raising awareness on mental health. Now we live in an age where there's a lot of sharing, whether it's mental health, depression.
It's very important to share, and it would be very hypocritical of me to say that it's important to share but then shy away from sharing myself.
And some helpful tips for families and children.
What's very important to tell parents is that you have to look for signs. You have to know what they are and you have to look for them.
Absolutely. To create that atmosphere where everybody can say what they want is very important.
So today I don't just have one amazing guest. I have three fantastic women of substance. I'm not going to give a huge introduction to each because I think you all know them and they're going to chat and reveal their amazing selves. So we have the amazing, amazing actress and director and supermom, Soni Razdan. And we have her two gorgeous kids, the superstar actress, Alia Bhatt, and her superstar author daughter, Shaheen Bhatt, who's written a book, I've Never Been Unhappier, that I honestly couldn't put down. I think it is, I'm never going to use the word brave because I know you don't like that. But I think to me, the word that really comes across is honest. Thank you, because I think it's doing amazingly with raising awareness on mental health, which is such a pertinent issue, such an important subject. Shaheen, how did you decide to be so honest?
I didn't decide. I've just been trained like that. My family is an incredibly honest family. My father is a very outspoken person. My sister's... both of them, my mom also to a huge extent. It wasn't really a decision that I made. It happened kind of slowly and over time. It started with an Instagram post that I did, which I talked about depression for the first time. It then flowered into articles that I wrote. And from there, it turned into a book. When Penguin approached me to write the book, I said yes immediately because it would be very hypocritical of me to say that it's important to share, but then shy away from sharing myself.
Absolutely.
So for me, it was just very important that I sort of lead by example.
I think that's incredible because I think, as you say in the book, you know, so often we're all putting up these sort of, I don't know if it's a show or what it is, but not really letting people in. And I happen to have done one of my first films with your dad, Saya. And I do remember you guys as kids then, don't want to reveal my age, but you know, at that time, and I do remember the honest outspokenness. So I think I've also grown up in a home which is very honest in that sense where we share a lot. So as a mom, Soni, could you tell that something was amiss or how did you kind of know? Was it only when Shaheen told you that she was battling with something or did you feel it?
There was something amiss, definitely, but I didn't know what it was. In the early phases, I would have just thought, yeah, she's being moody. But that was normal. I had absolutely no idea till she was about 17 and 18. And I think that her insomnia really hit her. That was the time that alarm bells rang in my head.
Yeah.
And she wouldn't get up in the morning naturally because she'd not been able to sleep all night. So I kept thinking, oh, it's a circadian rhythm. It's a body clock. It's something, something. My mind did not go to depression even once. Why would it? Because Shaheen was always a very happy child. I had no clue that behind the scenes, what was going on, which is she's I think, very well put down in
that,
her book.
That's what I was just about to say, that the honesty of some of those ages.
That's like for me, when I'm a mother, I was most of the time at home.
Yeah, not...
You know, it was not like I was out that much.
Yeah.
So I can't ever say to a parent that, okay, it's your fault that you didn't know. It's not. It's never. But I think what's very important to tell parents is that you have to look for signs. You have to know what they are and you have to look for them.
Absolutely. When I've, you know, seen some interviews where you've spoken about how you felt you didn't give enough or you didn't really understand enough and maybe was that kind of being maybe selfish to her? So how did you feel when you kind of, you know, read the book? And
I don't even remember that moment that it was kind of broken to me that Shaheen needs to get, you know, professional help. I just remember Mama and Shaheen suddenly became like this sort of like...
unit.
A unit. And they were always a unit, but this was a very different, like, okay, we have something to deal with. And they kind of kept me away from the whole, the nitty-gritties of it.
Yeah.
I got this sense, although my sister and I have had a very unique relationship. Like, we were always very, very close. Then we went through this period of not talking to each other for, like, what, 2 years?
Really?
3 months.
No, but I remember telling my friends that I'm a little worried about my sister. She doesn't get out of her room. Like, it was always dark. Like, walking into Shaheen's room was like walking into a cave. There was never light. Then, obviously, when I started understanding more, I still didn't understand enough, according to me, because I don't think I gave it enough importance. Yeah. Like, it was always like, she'll deal with it.
Yeah.
It was
not like... And she's your big sister. She's 6 years older, five and a half years older.
No, but the thing is, the kind of importance we give a fever in a house, if Shaheen were to tell me, I've got a bad throat, I've got fever, immediately the mind would be on alert.
Yeah.
oh, she's not well. Like, let's just all be aware of that. Depression is something that you think is like, you're sad and it'll pass. You don't really have an understanding of like, it's, you have to treat it the way you treat an illness.
Absolutely.
You know, with that much care and understanding.
Yeah, I think that's such a valid point because as you say, you know, so much in the book that mental health is so important. It is as important as physical health. And I think now there is more and more awareness about it, but there are still some stereotypes, right? People still talk about, oh, somebody's going to a therapist. And I really like what you wrote. I was a muggo in school, so page 108, you said something about how therapy is for everyone and yeah. It's actually just delving in to getting to know yourself. And I think that to me was such a poignant thing to say because yeah. there's still that subliminal stereotype. So how did you break that? I know your dad played quite a big part and your mom in saying there is no norm and what is normal. And,
her dad
and
thinks I can picture that him doing all that. Should not exist. Yeah.
Oh. But my dad has really? Never believed in any institution.
Does he think he's the one who can answer all your questions?
He doesn't. He's very...
He's a bit caveman-like.
He's very anti-establishment in that sense because he thinks that psychiatry and modern medicine are just, they're there to try and fit you into a particular system, and he believes that you should not ever try to fit into a system.
But that's not true. Therapy is
true, and that's also something I told him. I disagree with him because when you're going through something like that, you need to go to somebody who you believe has answers.
Absolutely.
Because you don't have the answers. You need to go to somebody who you think has got the answers. Psychiatry is still in very early stages right now where we are because there's a lot we don't understand about the human mind. But I still think there is still a vast amount of knowledge that we do have.
Yeah.
And using that knowledge, you can actually use that and use whatever you know to treat whatever mental illness that you're going through. I think for me, going to therapy was all my mother. She says she didn't have an inkling, but I think she had enough of an inkling because she kept gently suggesting to me that if you want to go to a therapist, you know, I'll find you a therapist. And when it got to the point where I thought whatever I was doing was not working, I went to her and I said, okay, I think it's time. Whatever you think we should do, we will do. And she's the one who took me to a therapist.
That's great. You know, hats off because honestly,
I was waiting for her to come to me. I knew that I could not force her.
And
she was too old, but she was not 12, you know, she was 18 or something like that. So just that's all I said is, I understand you can't talk to me, but there are people out there who can really help you.
Professionals who know how to do.
And I used to keep assuring her, whatever the problem is, we can fix it. I mean, I'm a fix-it person, so I'll say fix it.
No, I know.
Maybe we can't fix it, but but I will always look for that fix-it solution because that's just my nature, you know.
The way I am. And I think this whole thing of, again, another thing, what I really love about the book also is the diary and the personal anecdotes and the facts. And again, something that I didn't know is the difference between a psychiatrist and a psychologist and a psychotherapist and who can give a prescription and who can't. And it's really interesting to know.
And because the different kinds of depression as well, about the chronic and acute
mild.
The fact that depression doesn't mean the same as sadness, right? You just assume that when someone's sad, okay, they're depressed. But actually depression is when it happens without a reason.
Yeah.
And that's the...
There's no trigger.
Or there could be a trigger, but then it kind of like...
Yeah. For example, for me, I'm fairly certain that depression started off as a chemical thing for me. Because I dealt with it for so long, it became progressively more and more psychological.
Yeah.
So it became a part of my personality in a way. I imbibed a lot of the negativity of depression. As a result of that, I have a lot of self-esteem issues. I have a lot of all of that stuff, which those are the things that act as like psychological triggers on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah.
So depression over a long enough period of time will eventually become psychological because it is manifesting psychologically.
Absolutely. In that sense, does it become chronic? Because of that reason? Or
it can become chronic for that reason. I mean, again, it completely depends from person to person. And that's the thing. Somebody asked me, is there such a thing as complete healing? So I say, even for acute depression, even if you go through depression for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, and then you eventually get over it, you're still fundamentally changed by it.
Yeah.
Because you're not going to go back to being exactly the same person that you were before it. You get over it. It doesn't come back in that way. But it changes you.
Coming up, the times when I think when you were 17 or 18, when you tried to end your life. What were you thinking?
No, I wasn't thinking. I was just like, I can't do this anymore. I just physically felt like I couldn't do it.
I don't think I've ever said this before, but I went through acute depression.
Really?
Friend of mine lost a friend of hers very recently because he was depressed. He committed suicide. And that was the first time that anybody in my close circle, I had not been to a therapist And I keep talking about it as well. Shaheen keeps telling me that sometimes, you know, you've got so much going on in your life. It's important to even talk to another person. But she went for therapy and she did a couple of sessions and she really came out feeling much better. But recently we had this conversation and she said that, I don't think it'll ever go away. But and it's definitely changed something within me. I'll never go back to being the way I was. But I just deal with it differently now. She was not depressed, but she went to therapy because there was something...
She was grieving.
She was grieving.
She was grieving. Grief is a kind of...
Depression.
It's a kind of acute depression as well, because it can really take over your life and it can change.
Exactly.
It can fundamentally alter the essence of who you are as a person.
So that's what I mean by sometimes situations in your life also kind of push you into...
Yeah, I remember when my dad was unwell with emphysema. And for me, daddy's strongest. No one could be stronger in that sense and battling it for 10 years. But I know that my mother, for example, is definitely someone who would encourage even my dad that, you know, he was told it's terminal emphysema. So she said, you know, why don't you speak to someone? And he did. And I remember feeling like, oh, daddy's talking to some, you know, but it was actually so helpful. And that was a case of, again, dealing with knowing what everyone knows, as he says in from Julius Caesar, cowards die many times before their death, the valiant only taste of death but once. It seems to me most strange that men should fear death, a necessary end that will come when it will come. Because you speak about death and being afraid of death.
Yeah, I mean, we're living, breathing creatures and we're hardwired for survival. Of course, anything that goes in the face of that is going to be scary.
Yeah.
I think there's a difference. Some people think about it a lot more than others do think about it. I'm one of those people. I think about it a lot more than the people around me. I think it's perfectly normal to, you know, fear death and think about it.
The times when, I think when you were 17 or 18, when you tried to end your life, what were you thinking as in...
No, I wasn't thinking. I was just like, I can't do this anymore. I just physically felt like I couldn't do it. I'll be very honest. I don't think I actually made a very serious attempt at it. I think it was, in a way, it was for me like a cry for help to myself, in a way. I was like, I can't do this for one more second. I can't look out of the window for one more second and feel this dead and empty inside.
So it was the pain inside you that you couldn't bear anymore?
I just couldn't, it was too much.
I'll tell you why. I'll tell you how I reacted. I understood completely. Because there was a time in my life, and it was for a very short time. I don't think I've ever said this before, but I went through acute depression. Everything was lovely in my life. I was young, I was beautiful. I had a boyfriend also. Everything was fine. There was no apparent problem. But there was a little trigger which happened. And I started getting into this depression. And it got worse and worse and worse. In those days, there was no psychiatrist. There was no recourse to anybody. Parents would have not known nothing. So I didn't even say anything. I just went to my family doctor and said, Doctor, I don't feel like living. And he said, oh, no, no, beta, don't ever say that. Life is a gift. I said, I know it's a gift, but I feel sad all the time. So then he gave me some tablets which make me euphoric. And I used to go flying around all over the place and feel very happy. And when they were when I stopped taking them, I would come crashing down. So then I went to my homeopathic doctor and I said, this is what I've got. And she said, no, don't take those anymore. I'll wean you off them and I'll give you homeopathic medicine. It took some time, but I was mooning around the house like that. I didn't feel like going out and all. And I read a book called Stop Feeling Tired and Start Living. Some book like that. And some other book that was lying. There was just actually really good books because they just made me feel I wasn't alone.
Yeah.
Somebody's gone, been there before me. And I can get out of this situation that I'm in for some reason. I need to get out of it. And because perhaps I was not as wired as Shaheen or whatever, I managed to pull myself out of it with the help of the homeopathic, with the book, with whatever. And I've never had it again. But when she told me how she felt, there was a point in that time when I also didn't want to live. I said, how can I go on living like this? And I knew exactly what she meant.
Really?
Yeah. And so then I remembered that time in my life. I said, okay, I've been there. Maybe not as badly as you, but I had a reference point.
I think actually what you say about sharing is hugely helpful for anyone who's going through anything, whether it's mental health, depression, special needs, autism, Down syndrome. We had a guest on the show, parents with a little girl with Down syndrome, and she said, you know, her biggest help has been sharing because she knows that she's not alone. And you're doing that also with Here Comes the Sun. So tell us a little bit about that.
That's the thing. I feel like I've written this book and I feel like I've told my story, but I very strongly believe that this is not about me and it needs to go further than me.
Yeah.
I've used my story as sort of, like I said, it's like a kind of a conduit to share a message. And Here Comes the Sun is me taking that one step forward, essentially. It's just a campaign that we've sort of started to raise awareness. It's a community where people can come, where they can share, they can get information. It's just a support system that we're trying to build. I mean, the response to that has also been hugely positive. The reason, one of the reasons I did it was because I thought that if I had the kind of access to information when I was younger, in a way that I understood, in a way that was palatable to me at that age, I would have maybe recognized a lot sooner that I needed to go talk to my parents. I would have maybe started getting help a lot sooner. Perhaps wouldn't have gotten to the point that it got to.
Yeah.
So it's very important for me to provide that access to information and information in the right way.
Absolutely. And so, I think as a young parent, I think it's really helpful because, you wonder sometimes, that what are your kids really thinking? I don't know what's going on.
Sorry to cut you, but I also feel like it also leads by example, like, the fact that how honestly we can speak also is because our parents speak so honestly to us and to each other. To create that atmosphere where everybody can say what they want is very important, because I feel that's what happens where you alienate yourself from your family and you go to your friends first, or you go to your, boyfriend or girlfriend first, where I feel like you have to be able to say it at least to one member in your family. And that's what my dad would always say. He said, you can lie to yourself or lie to me or lie to your mother, but just find one person, just tell your sister the truth, or just tell your mother the truth. Just find one person that you can tell the truth to. And that makes such a world of a difference in understanding. Like, if Shaheen would not be so honest, who knows how long it would have taken her to find her path to getting better.
Absolutely. And I think there's a lot to be said for all of you, because I was going to ask, but then you both of you have said about how you've grown up being so honest.
We don't know any other way.
We don't know any other way of operating.
And just one more thing I want to say, as one of two sisters, I love my sister a lot, but I do feel siblings is an interesting relationship. In the book, you've been so honest, and so have you, about how, I know this has come up many times, but that it did make me feel like crying, that photo shoot story, right? When you were both little and went to meet your sister Pooja at a shoot, and the team there took Alia and Pooja aside and said how they're so cute and they resemble each other and left you out. And how people don't mean to be cruel, but it's very, and again, this is something I would have said to someone, how dare you do that? But at the time, you don't think of it. So did that ever do anything to you guys?
No, not at all. The thing is, I think we both will always have our individual feelings about ourselves. But what happened naturally, and I speak for both of us over here, is that we became a unit naturally. Like, we don't consider ourselves as two people. Like, we might as well be, joined by the hip, and we might as well be twins. Like, we don't consider ourselves very different, and I don't think we're very different. Like, there are many times where I was like, oh my God, that was exactly like Shaheen. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, you spoke exactly like Shaheen.
Oh my God, you look exactly like Alia.
Yeah.
You sound like Alia, you did that like Alia.
Yeah.
But that's so mature of you also, because I don't think there's ever, one thing I notice also in the book, that there's no blame. Like, you never ever say that, oh, they got the attention and they were in the thing and I wasn't. Just talk about how you felt.
Yeah, but I think that's the thing. I think how I felt was how I felt, and it's not brought into my relationship with my sister in any way. It's got nothing to do with her. You know what I'm saying? She's been the thing that's held me together. There's no possible way that there can be anything, any of it can go in that direction at all. And also, if I were to feel like that, I wouldn't be able to be so honest about it.
That's what's so wonderful. And that's what you need to shout out, because I think in a very surface level thing, it's a very normal thing to say, oh, someone has rivalry or this is that. But there's so much deep stuff, which is... which you're bringing out in this. And
like, I've spoken to so many sisters after Shaheen and I have spoken out together, being like, oh my God, we totally get it. We totally connect. So I don't think it's just us, it's sisters, like you were just saying with your sisters.
It's a relationship.
It's a relationship that you choose to have, and you choose to have it with extreme closeness. And I think we chose that.
No, I think that's incredible. Coming up.
My mom said to me before I became an actor that the one thing that you'll need as an actor is patience.
Just create an environment in the house where your children, if they need to, can come and talk to you. Second thing I want to tell children, talk to somebody about it. Do not let it get to the point where, it's going to affect your life in a negative way.
Like you, I'm mixed. So I'm half Indian and half English. I look very Indian. I sound very Indian. So I live here. It's interesting. My sister looks much more European and she lives in England.
Same.
I know. So I see sometimes your pictures and posts and I'm like, there are people who look at my mom who's, my mom. She's like light-haired. And they say, it's your real mother.
Mm.
And it really bothers me. So I don't know. I was just wondering, because you guys are kind of like how my kids will be. Like they're quarter something else.
Yeah.
Mine are quarter Nepali, quarter Sardar, quarter Indian, quarter English. So I don't know if this always has anything to do with your identity. You know, does it affect just, who you are in any way?
We call ourselves mixed breeds and we're food courts. We have all kind of cuisines.
Every cuisine.
And you enjoy that and accept that and enjoy that.
But as a kid, celebrate that.
Celebrate that. And I think that's the age now. So, last thing, do you guys feel, because you've all achieved such heights in everything you do, do you think that you're always learning or have you reached your...
No, so my father says if you feel like you know it all or if you're in a room with people who think they know it all, you need to go
get
to another room.
Yeah.
I don't think any of us subscribe to the thing of we know ever. We're all constantly learning. We're all curious minds.
That's why I feel like I could keep chatting because I'm also enjoying learning.
Yeah.
So any last tip to anyone out there who is not just going through depression. Honestly, I didn't want to make this heavy because I think, to be honest, as you say also in the book, that when you're depressed, it doesn't mean you're not also happy. So it's not one or the other. You can be having...
You can be both things, I mean, tips, share. That's the only thing that makes a difference. And also, depression is not your identity. It's not my identity either. This is one part of my story. This is not my story. And I'm glad that we can talk about it. And like I said, sharing is the most important thing that you can do.
That's lovely. Thank you for sharing here on the Tara Sharma Show. Anything you want to say, Alia, is like literally, honestly, the top of your game.
Well, I can say I know it's very, very tough to sometimes be waiting and have a lot of patience. But that's what my mom said to me before I became an actor, that the one thing that you'll need as an actor, even if you're doing well or not well, is patience. Just you have to be patient for a good time, patient for your shot to come, on the makeup chair. And patient for the right opportunities. So yeah, patience and belief. It's easier said than done, but yeah, those are the two things that you should keep with you very close.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Soni, any tips?
I think the most important thing I can just say to any parent, firstly, is that just create an environment in the house where your children, if they need to, can come and talk to you.
Yeah.
And if somebody says they're depressed, please do not say, oh, it's okay, beta, you will get over it. Here, have this laddu. It's not like that. It doesn't work like that. That's one. Take it seriously. Very important. Second thing I want to tell children, if you're feeling that you're not okay, it's okay to be not okay. Yeah. It also doesn't necessarily mean you are depressed or have got depression or are going to get depression. But if you feel that there is something wrong somewhere, things are not right, please talk to somebody about it. Do not let it get to the point where, you know, it's going to affect your life in a negative way.
Absolutely. And anything you want to say about climate change? Because I know you're very passionate about that. Saving the coast and the planet.
Yeah, well, there's too much, really. I think we'll have to have a whole another show for that.
Yeah.
But certainly, I think it's something that we have to take seriously. We don't have a choice today.
Yeah.
There's some really good things that have happened, like about the plastic in Maharashtra, for example, and all over the country it's happening, which is very good. But I think there's some certain things which we really need to now stop rushing into, like the coastal road.
Yeah.
There are so many good options and so many great architects out there who have options. We need to take this slow.
Absolutely.
We need to look at everything before we make a final decision. Please, let's not rush.
Absolutely.
It's very important.
It has to be responsible development.
It has
not
to
just
be.
Rushed,
yeah.
Hurried.
We have to weigh all the pros and cons and decide. More roads means more cars.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
We need to find out.
Thank you. We have reconnected thanks to our Instagram exchanges about all this.
Yeah.
But thank you guys
thank you so much.
And I'd love to say it with a kiss.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And also, here's a kid from Byju's, the learning app. It contains a personalized learning program specially crafted as per the student's syllabus. We'll be donating it to a student in need. I'm very strict about screen time, so now I'm learning to balance and allow them some screen time if it's sensible screen. Thank you guys
Thank you so much.
I get up to hug you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ta-da! Next week, we meet the number one bowler in the world, Jasprit Bumrah, who talks about his relationship with his family.
My mother never stopped me from playing cricket. She told me, I'm there to support you, I'm there to guide you. But after a certain period of time, you fight your own battles.
Meet some enthusiastic little fans.
How do you deal with pressure and not only on the pitch, but also outside?
It's similar to your exams. If you've not prepared well, then you're nervous that, oh, how would you deliver? If you've prepared well, if you've done everything, it's easy. Just you have to go there, it's just about execution.
And share some meaningful advice for kids and families.
If a young boy or a young girl has self-belief, they think that they can do it, that's the only opinion that matters.